could breed many.
Yes.
Please release them again. And of course, the Americans had the same idea, and they were always, I always say they were 2 years in front of us. But I must also say they had the better opportunity. They had falcons.
Yeah.
And they had money.
Which, well,
which we didn't have. We had very, very few falcons, and most of them were from falconers, very old ones, and not very useful for breeding.
Then I think you were given some from Scotland.
Later. The first one I got from Spain, from Felix de la Fuente. I wrote a letter and I said, I would like to have a... Have you... He was a friend of mine. Yes. I said, perhaps you have one female. We need a female. Not too old, not very good, must not be good falcon for falconry, but okay, must be safe, sound falcon.
Yeah.
And he said, yes, I have one, but I like to have a German pointer for that. A well-trained pointer for that.
Right.
And I said, no. But then I said, okay, yes. But I don't want to tell the whole story. But
don't worry.
It's a long story again. And
yeah.
It's a lovely story. But I got this female falcon, and she was the first which I had success in breeding with. And then, of course, we... In 78, no, when we were in Abu Dhabi.
76.
76 was Abu Dhabi. I met Professor Wynne Edwards from Aberdeen.
Yes.
And he said, why don't you apply for a license for peregrines for your project? And I couldn't believe that, you know. I couldn't believe, which would never have been possible in Germany, coming abroad. And somebody says, wouldn't you like to have peregrines? I couldn't believe it. And he said, apply for four, you might get two. And so I went back and wrote from the university. You know, that was quite helpful, being a member of the university and starting a program at the university. And
this was Berlin University.
Berlin University, Freie Universität Berlin. And I got, I think a week later, I got a letter. Yeah, they can't decide just now because they have their meeting in 2 weeks or 3 weeks' time, and then they'll give. And I tell you, I got the license for four peregrines.
I remember.
It was nearly incredible for us.
Yeah.
And they said, you can take the peregrines north of the river, so and so, I don't know. And I said, I never come to take peregrines. You have to give peregrines to me.
Right.
Which was difficult because these peregrine people in the north of Scotland, they didn't want to give the peregrines to us, but they got the pressure from the authorities.
Yeah.
And so I sent a co-worker of mine, Dirk Geritz, and he collected the peregrines, which was a pity because they just, and he was not allowed to be with them.
Right.
And they took four females, which was a real problem for us. We had four females now and no males. We had just two males. And anyway, they started the special line of breeding peregrines for release and of course later for falconry also. That was a great thing. Later in the 19th we got another, we got more, six peregrines, but this was of course not so dramatic as it was.
No, because it wasn't when they were so endangered.
Yeah,
and,
right.
Yeah. So I don't think many falconers nowadays realise how bad, how difficult it was to get a peregrine.
No.
Yeah, how sought after.
I was really accused that I was flying the tiercel in a time where there are no peregrines about, and they were right. Mm-hmm. It was a risk. If I would have lost Justa forever, we would have had very difficult times.
Yeah, but it's been an incredibly successful thing. Well, and in America, but...
Yes, I mean, it has been very successful, though we had a lot of pressure against our programs from ornithologists. Big organizations. And the real good thing was we succeeded.
Yes.
Even against the pressure from the so-called peregrine experts, which was surprising because it was not a very nice time, because they always wanted to stop these programs.
For what reasons?
Because we were falconers.
And that's they all. Had,
yes, because their thinking and what they always said, that the falconers were guilty for the disappearing of the peregrines.
Of course, yes.
Yes, and they couldn't stand that falconers said, we will have to rescue the peregrine, because they said, you are guilty that they are not there anymore. But they didn't know anything about pesticides, or they didn't want to believe in the beginning. But yeah. Afterwards, I mean, now nowadays nobody, or everybody knows how the real things were. But they are still against that, because they don't like falconers.
Yes, they think we do damage. And
that's horrible.
With
yes,
no reasoning.
Yeah. No and the young people, they don't know anything about it at all. I mean, they don't know how endangered the situation for falconry, especially in Germany, maybe in other parts of the world as well. Americans had the same problems, but they were much more powerful than we were.
Yes.
Was helpful that I was a member of the University of Berlin and I could make a project there, a scientific project out of it. I think that was a good thing.
Yes, I'm sure that helped. But I mean, all that and the you were able to produce peregrines for falconers as well. That's been a huge advantage for. German falconry has got really.
Yes, after a while, other falconers started to breed, and they succeeded in breeding, especially Dr. Trauma, and more came. And the peregrine in captivity was not endangered anymore because we had more and more and men. I mean, just in our project were, I think, more than 1,000 bred already, and most of them have been released. And I think. They are the root for the populations nowadays, which of course our enemies deny completely. You know, you will never hear anything for that. And in East Germany, it was completely different because they had no peregrines at all. The first pair breeding after the crash was one pair from us coming from West Germany. At this time, we couldn't work together.
Yeah.
And they said immediately, oh, they got the rings, or they are, and we knew they were from our first release and first and second release from Hessen, which is near the was near the border, and they told us all the time, you know, every single bird they knew from the rings.
Wow.
In West Germany, they denied it. Incredible.
So why?
Well, because they have to. I don't know. They are special people, maybe. And after the reunification, which was a real great, we could work together immediately. Yeah. They came next day. There were three on my front door.
Wow.
And they came. It was Dr. Kleinstäuber, Professor Kilmse, and Hans Ebert. And they said, we want to do work together for the peregrine. And we sat down, had a bottle of whiskey, and I think this bottle was empty at the end of the evening, but we made the plans starting with Sächsische Schweiz, with Schweiz, which was completely empty, no peregrines, which was in former times one of the Eldorados of peregrines.
Right.
And it took us 7 years to repopulate this area.
That's very quick, really.
Very quick, yes. And of course, in Turing and everywhere were our falcons. And I think one was coming from southern Germany, but all the others from our releases. And then we had the great program of the tree nesters. one must say that's a special population which was huge, spreading from East Germany to the Ural, to all the eastern countries.
Yes.
Completely extinct. Nothing left. All no DDT. And we had the idea, and I think we were quite right, they couldn't come do this again. I always say they are not only tree nesters, but they are forest nesters. They are nesting in the dense forests, which peregrines usually don't do. And so we started to release them under special conditions, and we started in 1990, and we stopped in 2012, because our goal was reached.
Okay, that's a really short time. Quick.
Yes, that's so a short quick. Time. And then now are going on themselves. No releases anymore. Every year more and more and
the
more.
Peregrines.
I think they have, I don't know, I shouldn't say, because I always forget numbers and figures, but I think there are more than 50 pairs now.
Wow.
And the interesting thing is most of the offspring are nesting against in tree nests, in forest nests, on ravens' nests mainly,
yes.
and sea eagles' nests and ospreys' nests. And of course, if they start to nest somewhere and the nest is falling to pieces, a raven's nest after four young ones, there's not nothing left. We put artificial nests there, and they use them quite well. So that's the program, and we stopped it because we said we want to have 25 pairs. When we reached 25 pairs, we stopped the program, which we did when we had 30.
Right.
And I must say, that couldn't have been done without the East German peregrine protectionists. They were completely different than our West German fellows.
Really?
And completely, yeah. Anyway, that was a great success, and nobody can say they're coming from their protection.
No.
They're just from the lease.
Just from the lease?
Yes.
From Falconers?
From Falconers.
Which is the big thing.
Yeah, but not, I mean, well, Falconers couldn't have done it on their own.
No, sure.
But the idea was, I for instance, I constructed the first artificial tree nest for release, which is it's a problem to feed them from the ground. You can't climb every day the young ones and feed the young ones. So this was the first thing we did, and it's still used nowadays, still in Poland now. I mean, they're doing it not in Germany anymore, but in Poland.
But it's so exciting that partly through what you did in Europe, but also in England, where they haven't done
shouldn't be there because they've never been there traditionally, you know.
Yeah.
There has been maybe one or the other just nesting on a tree, mainly when they had the problems with the original nest and 1 or 2 years and then finished again.
Yeah.
But this is a real stable population which should spread to the eastern countries, up to the northern Finland and maybe southern Sweden and to the Ural.
Right.
I think they can do it, because birds from our releases and offspring are breeding now in Poland, together with the ones we released just now, together with the Polish ornithologists and falconers.
Yeah.
So that's a good idea. But I always say, I think this should be said now, nature is really in real danger. And I always say, what we did with the peregrine, besides of all the problems we had with people, it was an easy task.
Right.
Please try to do it with a lark.
Yeah.
Impossible. And this, I think, is a very serious thing we have to think about.
I think a lot of the conservation groups, they switch on to something like a peregrine, because it's a state.
Yes, of course.
But even if you take the red grouse in Scotland, which has gone down, the percentage it has fallen by is maybe bigger than the percentage that the peregrines fell by in some areas. But because it's a quarry species used for the shooters one, the RSPB aren't interested. and no work is really done by any of the big bodies to protect larks or
insects.
Insects
in Germany.
Yeah.
No, you know, when I drive with my car, or I drove years before, in a warm summer day, I could had to stop every 100 kilometers to wipe my windscreen, because you couldn't see anymore.
Yeah.
This is not necessary anymore. No. There's no insect dying on my car.
No, it's only, I notice the difference between England and Scotland. In Scotland, you still get...
Is it better?
It's better with the north of Scotland.
In Italy, it's still better than in Germany.
Yeah, but in England, you don't get insects on the car. Like, maybe a few, but...
And this is the food for so many birds.
Yeah.
So, these are the real problems, because at the end, it will affect human beings.
Yes.
But modern agriculture is killing everything.
Mm. It's frightening.
Okay, yes. I think we could stop it here. Yeah. Don't you think so? I don't know. I mean, I'm not the man for interviews.
It's tiring, and it's